Welcome back, global townsfolk. In our History of Earthquakes episode, I spoke of the prediction of the 1975 Liaoning, China earthquake. I also noted that this was a unique event, and that prediction of earthquakes has not proven itself as well as some of the other predictive aspects of the science. So what was it that the Chinese government looked at to let them know an earthquake was possibly coming? The ground was said to shift vertically before the quake. Radon gas in wells increased, and well levels rose and fell. Magnetic anomalies were observed, and then there were all those small earthquakes leading up to the main quake, what are known as foreshocks, which were the biggest alarm to the government officials, causing them to urge people to stay outdoors for the next couple days. And when the big quake did hit, the people had taken their families out of houses and livestock out of barns, and though there was a reported 90% destruction of houses in some places, there were very few deaths, emphasizing again the general trend that earthquakes don't kill people, buildings kill people. It seems that Liaoning, China was a slam dunk proof that we can predict earthquakes and save lives. But the devil's in the details. The ground shifts were comparable to other shifts measured which did not lead to major earthquakes, or the evidence of major earthquakes without those preceding ground shifts. The same goes for radon, or water levels in wells. But the foreshocks, they seem a little more reliable, right? It's like that pop, pop, pop before the big crack of a stressed object. But there is a real issue here that no small earthquake is called a foreshock until a main shock takes place. There are plenty of examples of large shocks with no foreshock swarms to warn. We call a large number of smaller quakes grouped together in time a swarm. So there have been swarms with no main shock, and shocks with no swarms. So we'll just call it an earthquake swarm and not a series of anticipatory foreshocks giving warning of a big shock. And so, with this one case of earthquake prediction, we already see that its powers are very limited. But we are not yet willing to give up, and still yearn for the clues to predict quakes reliably. To summarize, the main methods used are ground deformation, water levels in wells, radon gas in wells, foreshocks, P-wave velocity changes, electrical resistivity changes in the rocks preceding and around the point of failure. Possibly, too, we could measure fluctuations in the Earth's magnetic field before a big quake, but in a land of unreliable predictors, that one ranks near the bottom. So, changes in ground elevations. It was first noticed in a famous study from Japan, when geodetic stations on the coast of southern Japan measured drastic elevation changes in millimeters, not in meters, but still geologically drastic changes before the onset of the Niigata earthquake of 1964. Again, this seems like a slam dunk for earthquake prediction, until you realize that this data was sifted through and released after the main quake. Later investigations brought this data into question, with an inability to replicate in other cases of ground deformation producing no main shock, or shocks with no ground deformation. In this case, we had a lot of suspicion of conscious or unconscious manipulation of the original Japanese data. Now, if you haven't caught on already, this is the general reason we don't trust many of the other earthquake precursors. Either we see the precursor with no significant event, and or get such events without the precursor signals, or we often suspect those producing positive results of wishful thinking, purposeful manipulation, or more generously, just simple misinterpretation. The electrical resistivity issue was noted in deep wells in Russia, with a drop in electrical resistivity before the quake. The thought is that rocks get stressed and release more free electrons to transmit electricity, thus electrical resistivity drops. Yet again, this process suffers from the previously mentioned problems of coincidence and wishful thinking. And yet, changes in rock properties like this and others are thought to precede large quakes, which leads to the idea that P waves may change velocity through the stress zone before the quake. This would be due to pressure changes on stressed rocks. But to be realistic, the gravitational stress is so much more at those depths for this possible stressor to give much credit. But we're desperate for evidence, and so we keep it in the arsenal. And on we go, and find that every one of the methods we've mentioned have turned out to be unreliable. And this is a serious problem for developed and undeveloped countries alike. In less developed rural China of 1975, it was winter when people were told to live outdoors for a few days, and then they had to rebuild their homes and buildings. But for developed areas, just imagine you decide to predict an earthquake in a place like Los Angeles or San Francisco for the next year. Just think of the societal and economic impacts that would take place in that year. Drop in property values and the associated drop in property tax revenue. Insurance and mortgage will be harder to get and more expensive. People possibly moving away temporarily or permanently. Loss of outside investments and rescheduling or canceling public events and services. And what if we're wrong? All that for nothing. Earthquake prediction and response may be a bit more effective in an authoritarian developing society like China, able to force their population into uncertain positions, but Japan or United States or Turkey will not be so able to cope with that uncertainty. I haven't even mentioned one of the worst problems with this prediction scheme. Prediction efforts are concentrated on places where we expect major earthquakes to occur. As such, the baseline prediction of a major earthquake at that location will already start out above zero. And if you act like the psychics network and make a completely uninformed guess that a major earthquake will occur in Japan or California in the next year, you might turn out to be right by just playing the probability game. But even if you're a sophisticated seismologist with all the technology to bear on the problem and you think you've predicted a major earthquake, the actual occurrence of a major earthquake does not prove you right. There was already a non-zero probability of such a quake, and your prediction needs to be substantially above this baseline predictive level. So far, nothing has panned out. Look up the Parkfield experiments if you'd like more detail on that. So right now, at present, we have to say that major earthquakes are unpredictable in short timescales. But we just said that the non-zero probability in a location means we already expect larger earthquakes on a longer timescale, and so in a sense we can predict earthquakes if we broaden our temporal view. There are places on Earth where earthquakes are more frequent, and if we can get long enough records of the major events, we can start to predict how often we could expect such an event, its recurrence interval. Depending on the place on Earth and the kinds of governments that existed there, we can get a historical record of how often large quakes take place in that location. But often these large quakes are on centuries scales, and historical records in some places can run out quickly. However, we can turn to good old geology and look for and date the various disturbances of the geologic record made by large quakes. Previously, we discussed Seattle and what is known as the Arcadia Slip Zone, which could cause major damage to the Pacific Northwest. This film shows the evidence from tsunami deposits and deep water ocean turbidite deposits made by submarine landslides showing the frequency of large events along the upper western United States coast. Marking these on a timeline makes us think that the next large quake in this area may occur tomorrow, or in the next couple centuries. Either way, we say that another large quake is due in relatively recent geologic time for the Pacific Northwest, and so they should prepare. Another way to look at this is to observe all the quakes on this active tectonic boundary and realize that every quake releases stresses on the moving rocks, with smaller quakes removing less stress and large quakes more. But if we have an area with a lot of small quakes, they may add up to release the stress there and prevent any major quake from ever building up. Conversely, an area along an active plate boundary or fault that sees released stress all around it, but nothing within a specific area, that area becomes a very risky place for larger quakes. If you don't get the smaller quakes to release the stress, you're just building up until a catastrophic break. So it is with Seattle. And so it is with LA. When we look at the southern San Andreas Fault, we see an area of low seismic activity where we would expect regular earthquakes in the best case. We know from history of a truly devastating Mercalli scale 10 to 11, so we assume that it was a Richter scale 8 in 1857, which makes us worried that this area does not release its energy slowly in regular small quakes, but gives periodic large shocks that could devastate modern LA. But we also have those geologic investigations on the fault showing the following pattern in time of major quakes in that area. The earliest identified major quake was in 545 AD. then 665, 860, 965, 1190, 1245, 1470, 1745, and the historic shaker of 1857. This record of ancient large quakes shows an average time elapsed between quakes to be around 164 years. Here in 2017, we have gone 160 years without another large event. So if this fault popped like regular clockwork, we'd expect another large quake in Southern California around 2021. Then again, the shortest time between quakes was 55 years, so we know it could pop any day now. Then again, the largest wait between these events was 275 years, in which case we would wait around until 2130 or 2140 for the shock. So, though we have had, you know, some pretty big quakes around LA, seismologists know a larger southern quake is due. And so California has done two more things to protect against such shaking: mitigation and preparation. That will be the focus of our next episode here on Earth Explorations.